presence of the Lord is here. some. God in the Holy Ghost, God the three in one. I know God is God. Oh, God don't never change. I know God. Oh, He always leads me. Oh, God when the lightning flashes, God when the thunder rolls. Yes, hallelujah. Oh, I speaks to me.
You know glory to God, that God is already moved. God's already done it. He's already worked it. And you say, praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. 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 You know, years ago, When you may be seated, when my granddad was holding church over across town in the old cigar factory, and God had begun to move, and I'm telling you, he was doing something new among them. And one night, when the anointing was on him to pray for the sick, he had called for him to come and let him minister to him. And Sister Ernest had, with her sister, had knots and tumor growths all over her hands. They had come up all over them on the front and the back. And when she got down to the front to be prayed for. He asked her what she'd come for. And she said, well, Brother Edwards, I've come for you to ask God to take these tumors off my, growths off my hands. But she said, when I started around the aisle to come to you, every one of them disappeared. Hallelujah. Woo, glory to God. Amen. I said, amen. Our great grandmother went to Brother Eller, had a cancer on the side of her face, a tumor, and he prayed for it. She didn't look like nothing happened. She went on believing, sat down to see. When she sat down to see, it fell off in her lap. You got to go believing. You got to go everywhere you go believing. I don't care what it looks like. Don't care what it sounds like. Don't care what it smells like. Don't care what it tastes like. I believe and I'm believing. I'm going believing. I'm going believing. I'm going believing. Going believing. I don't care if it looks like the roof's about to cave in. I'm going believing. I'm going in faith. Amen. I'm going believing it's done. Can you say amen? Jesus said, go thy way. What did he say? Go thy way. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Is that what he said? Go thy way, doubting nothing. Your faith hath made you whole. Brother, sister, this morning, walk on. That's all you can do. Walk on. Everybody else may sit down. Everybody else may have to ponder it a while. Everybody else may be in the valley of decision, still trying to figure out what they want to do. But you got you got to keep marching. You got to keep walking. You got to keep moving. Everybody say, keep moving. Well, rolling stones gather no moss. Hallelujah. If you don't want all that stuff getting a hold of you and attaching to you, it's hard for the serpent to latch on you when you're shouting around. Glory. It's hard for that arthritis to get in your joint when you're all the time jogging around and thanking the Lord for healing. It's hard for that stuff to get you down when you don't be still. But I'll tell you what, if you sit down and you ponder long enough, it'll start grabbing you here and grabbing you here and grabbing you here and grabbing you here. Praise the Lord. Amen. You know, little Sister Brown, Jerry's mother, most of y'all seen her in her milder times, later years. But I'm telling you, when we was kids, she did more than just dance around in the pew, brother. When she got through, she'd been around the church four or five times, and you didn't dare get out in the aisle when she was going around, or unless you wanted to run with her, because she'd grab you and take you with her all the way. Amen? Yeah. Take you with her all the way. I couldn't even give her a Mother's Day flower without her dancing in the spirit. I'd send the usher down and give her a pretty bouquet for Mother's Day. She'd grab it and just take off a dancing. Hallelujah. Well, nothing grows on you when you don't get in there. You start that pondering and that questioning, wondering. Yes. And the longer you sit, the more your stupid mind will drive you crazy. Won't it do it? Yeah. You sit there and before you long, you have went for an hour pondering on why this is the way it is. And why won't this change? But I'll tell you, we ain't going to ponder today. Only thing we're pondering or looking upon is the glory of the Lord. Can you say amen? Amen.
I want you to take your Bibles and open them to the 2 Kings chapter 13. Praise the Lord. I've been preaching quite a many messages to you on Elisha and Elijah. Ain't through yet. But I'm going on with a... this is going to be a part of the other part of that message that I brought to you last Sunday morning on maximum effect. And last Sunday morning I went back a few chapters and we learned to preach to you about Jehu. How many was here for that? And how the Lord instructed them to take a brand new box of oil and break it open and pour it on his head. Oh my. And when he got it poured on his head, he come under a brand new anointing for a king. And God in one moment raised him up and gave him the throne. And anointed him so heavily that he could ride furiously. Glory to God. Amen. and the Lord begun to speak to us about maximum effect. We want the maximum benefits of the anointing of God. None of this slip by, slide by, barely get through it, but we want maximum results. Glory. Maximum exposure to the Holy Ghost. I don't want to see how little I can get in a service like this. I don't see, can't I just get it all took care of while I'm here? Praise the Lord. You know, if you went to the doctor and you had two bad toenails, you'd be a fool to sit there and let him fix one of them and tell him you'd be back when the other got to hurt you. You might as well tell him, just get them both while I'm here. Well, that's what we're telling the Lord to do this morning while you sit here under the anointing. Just fix it all. Don't just heal my elbow and leave my knee hurt. Just fix it all. Don't just touch my spirit, lift me up, and my finances stay in the mess. Just let me get it all. I believe in what's called the total package. I believe over there in James 5, that little verse said the prayer of faith shall save the sick. I know what that word save means. That means in every area. God don't just fix up. Folks, I'm telling you this morning, He don't just do little repair jobs. He transforms. He translates. He renovates the whole building, the whole house. God of Ohosha. And the place He starts is right here. If He can get this right here cleaned out, this right here will line up. You understand that? Praise the Lord. I heard the Spirit say just then the root of the issue. Hallelujah. I see in my spirit where the Lord's told the fig tree, don't dry up at the leaf. Don't dry up at the branch. Dry up at the root. And I think sometimes we're thinking just like we all do when we're out there in the summer heat, spring cleaning our yards. And the worst thing in the world to do is dig something up by the root. So we cut it just as low as we can, hoping that it won't come back. And then before spring gets here, before winter gets here, you notice that old bush has grown out again. Did you ever try to kill a bougainvillea? You can't kill one. You ain't gonna kill one unless you take an axe and bust right through the roots and dig it up in pieces, or unless you gash it and burn it out of there. You ain't gonna get it out no other way. Well, glory to God. Now, how many of you understand on one side of the fence that's a wonderful thing? It means nothing can't take you out. But on another side of the fence, it deals with our thought patterns. And if they're not completely annihilated from our memory, we will go back to them. It never matters how much I think I've uprooted religion out of me. I still run into a case now and then where religion rises back up. And so I am here to tell you today God is doing more than just see. When we grew up, the Lord put our granddad in what was called the deliverance ministry. And you got to understand, today you say that, people say, oh yeah, I know what that is. Back then you said that in his day, nobody knew what it was. All they knew was denominations. Amen. But he got a hold of the word of God to see where nobody had to suffer with anything. God would deliver you from anything. And he preached that there was nothing too big, nothing too major, nothing, no disease, no sickness, no infirmity that God could not do away with out of you, you know. Well, he was invited to in South Alabama to a church. It was a Pentecostal church, but it was a denomination church. And he began to preach deliverance. He had a circuit of deliverance scriptures. He'd go through that Bible. Each student knew where he was going to start and he knew where he was going to finish. He taught it just the way the Lord taught it to him. And he got through teaching, preaching. This old man come up and took him by the hand and said, brother, I know what you're preaching. I see what you're preaching. But he said, nobody in this church, including the pastor, has any idea what you just told them. They had never had heard it before. Can you say amen? But under that kind of ministry, I learned there ain't nothing you can't overcome. There ain't nothing you can't overcome. No fear, no depression, no weakness, no none of it, none of it, none of it. Here, one of the favorite places we was taught to go to was that scripture in Romans. It said, who shall separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus? Tribulation can't do it, peril can't do it, famine can't do it, nakedness, sword, war can't do it, not even death shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. He went on to say, he that spared not his son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? And when we read all things, we believed all things. I still believe it when I read it. I don't believe there's never anything that tries to come to up or forth in my life that opposes what I know to be the truth of God. I don't believe there's one thing that I'm able to sit down and say, well, it's expected for me to feel this way. Or it's expected. You know how people are. Well, you know, instead of telling you God will deliver you, they just pat you on the back and say, bless your heart, I know it. Well, it's only natural. I'm so tired of the natural. I could vomit this morning over. I believe in the supernatural. I get tired of people saying, well, it's only natural for you to hurt. It's only natural for you to be depressed. It's only natural. For no, 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 no. And we're about to see how that prophetic anointing will pick you up and set you in front of a window. Oh, glory. It'll anoint you to open that window. Well, glory to God. And it'll give you an anointing to see past your present. Not only that, but it'll give you an anointing to see that once the work's done, it's done. And you don't have to go back and redo nothing. And if you don't believe that'll cost you something, ask Moses. He hit the rock, didn't he? Can you say amen? Now, I really don't have time to read these scriptures, but I guess I better. I didn't read none at all last Sunday. And 2 Kings 13, you got it? Verse 14. Elisha was falling sick of his sickness whereof he died. And Joash, last week it was Jehu, this week Joash, the king of Israel, came down unto him, wept over his face, and said, O my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And Elisha said unto him, take bows and arrows. And he took unto him bow and arrows. And he said to the king of Israel, put thine hand upon the bow, and listen to this. And he, being put his hand upon it, and Elisha put his hand on the king's hand. Yeah. There's a marriage of a ministry taking place in this hour, folks. The supernatural and the divine, the word and the spirit is coming together in this hour. Can you say praise the Lord? The king and the prophet are putting their hands upon one another. And nations are about to tremble. I said nations are about to feel a shaking. Because the prophet is getting ready to put his hand on the hand of the king. And the whole force of God is fixing to come into play. And you fixing to see men sat down and raised up just like the clock ticks around the thing. It ain't going to be through a vote or a meeting, through a parliament, by God, through a board or a government system. It's going to be God bringing down one and uplifting another. And he's going, glory to God. Hallelujah. And he said, verse 17, he said what? Open the window. Open the window eastward. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Eastward. You watch the sun set long enough. You've sat there and watched it all go down. you fixing to go to the other side of the house. I come by Shunda and watch it all resurrect. Hey, glory! I said you'd understood on one side of the house long enough. Watching it all go down. See, it goes down on the west, but it comes up on the east. And so that's one of the places we're going to hit in just a moment. God's fixing to move you to the other side of the house. You get ready to look out the other window. Can you say amen? Woo! Hallelujah! And finally, he told him when he opened the window, shoot it. Bless God, quit shooting out of the wrong window. Quit. And I'll deal with that these days. I'm just trying to read the scripture. He said, shoot, and he shot. And he said, now everybody shout direct obedience. That's what God will bless you with. If the prophet speaks and you'll obey it, it'll happen. Believe his prophets, and so shall you prosper. Is that what the Bible said? And some people, they got to weigh it in detail, don't they? Come on now. They got to weigh it in detail. Find out if it's God or not. Well, I'm put your little mind at ease. The devil ain't going to say one word to you in this meeting this morning.
That's right.
God, ain't no devils around here.
Right.
He's been lying over there with a broke back for 2,000 years. He can't even get off the ground. How do you reckon he crawled in here this morning? Amen. If he's here, you brought him.
Right.
I didn't bring him, but if he's here, you brought him. And if you really want to cast something out, look in the mirror once in a while. And take care of that devil. In that mirror, it tells you all day long what you ain't. When God's told you in one eternal word what you are. Hallelujah. And so he said, behold the era of the Lord's deliverance. And God's getting ready to shoot such an arrow into some of our lives. And this is deliverance, that meaning this is just going to cut through everything. This, you know, the word is powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And it's for the purpose of cutting away all that bondage. And once again, when we speak of bondage, we're not talking about things you do, we're talking about ways you think. Because what you do is a product of how you think. So you can take... you can take candies away from babies all day long, but if you throw another piece down there, do you really believe because you took it away 5 minutes ago that they're going to automatically ignore that piece of candy? Well, no, they're not. They're going to get it. You know why? Because their head still says, I want candy. I see colors. I see wrappers. I see it and I want it. And that's the way we are. You can deal with the actions all day long, but if you don't take the source away, you'll just get a repeat of the same match. That's the reason I teach you. You can get healed all day long around here. It's easy to get healed in here, but if you don't heal this while you're healing this, guess what? This will need in another month or so, probably healing from the same problem again, because it's not registered yet in your mind that it cannot dwell there. Because you're a child of the Most High God, your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. Can you say amen? So he said, shoot it, and he shot it, and the Lord said, it's there, the Lord's deliverance. And he said, you're going to smite these Syrians until they're consumed. Consumed. And so he took it. And then I ain't got time. I'm losing my time trying to have Bible study with you all. But you know what I mean. You get what I'm saying, don't you? In the end of it, though, is what I want to quote to you now. The Lord came to him and said, ain't no more shooting to be done. Once it's shot, it's shot. Once God said it, it's done. Once the prophet prophesies, it's over with. Once you get a revelation in your spirit that God has done it, it's over with. So the Lord said, take the rest of them arrows. Don't shoot them. Take the rest of them. What do you want me to do with them? Smite them on the ground. Pick them up in your hand and say, it's done. Hallelujah. And he did it only 3 times. And he had more than 3 arrows, didn't he? Now, I'll tell you my belief. Now, this and a dollar might buy you a coat today. But I'll tell you what I personally believe. I believe every time he slung the arrow down, he broke it. And I believe the reason the prophet got so wroth with him is because he left a few. So if the first shot didn't work, he'd have backup. And I come to tell you this morning, if you can receive it, God's tired of you having backup plans for when the first one fails. God don't have no emergency exit.
Amen.
Can you say amen? And I think sometimes we're holding a few arrows back in our quiver. We got our, drawing card. We got the old ace tucked back just in case we're dealt a bad hand. Can you say amen? And then we're going to somehow slip one over on God and get ourselves out of this mess. Now, I'm preaching better than your shout. Instead of just believing God's going to do it all, we got a way to get ourselves out of this mess. How many is understanding that? So the first thing for you to see is, just like I was preaching to you Wednesday night, the Lord said to Elijah, you getting ready to prophesy to kings. And the Lord spoke to us on how we're getting ready to prophesy instead of prophesying to people who won't respond to the word of the Lord. Instead of always being plagued by people who hear it and hear it and hear it and never do it. The Lord says, I'm raising you up now to a new level of ministry. And the one you address now, not only will have the ear to hear, but he'll have the power. Oh, praise God. To activate the word of the Lord. For the Bible says where the word of a king is, there is power. It also says it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, but it's in the heart of a king to search it out. So there's already something in a king that understands power, understands dominion, understands authority. Praise the Lord. And when you receive it this morning, I'm telling you there's a king in every one of you that understands power. Oh, glory. That's the whole story of the man with the centurion servant, is it not? There was a man up there in that house that was a centurion. He understood power. He understood authority. He understood what it was to speak. And somebody bring forth what he spoke. Glory to God. If he was a centurion, he was at least a general over 1,000, maybe more. But we know he at least had 1,000 men under him. And he said, I say to this one, go over there, and he goes. I say to this one, come over here and stand by me, and he obeys me. I know what power, oh glory to God, I know what power is. I know what authority is. And he said to Jesus, you ain't got to come up in my house and prove nothing to me. I know you got power. I'm a man of power, and I sense that power in you. And you don't have to come in there for my sake. In fact, he said it this way, I'm not even worthy that you should come on. What he meant was, I'm not like these people that are doubting whether or not it's going to happen. I understand you're a man of power, and all you need to do is let me hear you say it, and when you say it, I know it's done. And Jesus said, I can't find this kind of faith in Israel nowhere. He said, all they do is seek after a sign. And I'm going to tell you something, folks, in the words of Kenneth Hagin, we've hunted the spectacular till we've missed the supernatural. Before we'll ever really buckle down and bring forth the plan God has given us, we want him to wave a sign over our head. I'm preaching now. We want to see something. Well, glory to God. Jesus said, "Saidest thou not unto you, if you believe, then you'll see the glory of the Lord." Can you say amen? Oh, praise the Lord. I'm telling you, God's got a king. Here's this King Joash. And the Bible said Elisha wasn't even in good shape, was he, physically? He was sick unto death. He had prophesied 60 years. 60 years he'd been prophesying. And it had been 40 years since the last word, if the people's right. That's their category, not mine. I don't know how to fix that stuff, but that's what they say. I just know that years of reading it. They said 40. It had been almost 45 years since he, the last word I preached to you last Sunday, where he had Jehu anointed. 45 years is a long time to go silent without anybody hearing from you. But that's the way people are in the ministry. If you ain't out there rocking their world and building them a new boat every day, you suddenly become forgotten about.
Right.
Now, as long as you tickle them where they want to be tickled and pour out that gold on them all the time, you're heard of. But sometimes you need to admire a man or a woman of God just because they've got the word in them. Not because they've delivered it yet, not because they've spoken it to you personally yet, but just because you know the anointing resides in them and because you know they're children and ordained of God. Don't shout me down now. It's easy to honor a man or woman of God. When revivals broke out in full fledged, everybody honors them then. One of the greatest messages I ever heard is the story of how T.D. Jakes rose into the ministry. Nobody believed it to this day, but he was a nearly nothing nobody. He had a little old country church in Virginia, Virginian mountains. They was in poverty. They didn't have nothing. And you say amen. He's very comical with it. He talked about having conventions and him and his wife working all day and then getting on cooking barbecue to feed all the people at the convention. And he said that he had done so good and got it all prepared and scrubbed his barbecue off his hands and all. And he went on the platform to start the convention. And unbeknown to him, he had squirted barbecue sauce all over his tie and his suit. And the brother on the platform said, "Brother Jakes, you got a little barbecue on your tie." Amen. He talked about how nobody would help him. If he broke down by the road, he had to wait till somebody come along that could tow him somewhere. Nobody would help him. Nobody wanted him to get their house. None of that stuff. Yet God miraculously moved, supernaturally set him up through a book and a word for one divine ministry opportunity to open the rest of his life of glory for it. And he's anointed by God. But he never did get the big head over it. He just as plain as me and you. You listen to him talk, you'll get right down on where we're at and minister to us. Amen. I personally think he preaches more by accident than most preachers do on purpose. Praise the Lord. And if you're wondering who I'd recommend you to listen to often as far as television ministers go, he'd be at the top of the list. T.D. Jakes would any day of any week. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He got revelation. He don't preach by the book. He preaches by this book, the Holy Ghost on the inside. Can you say amen? But one of the greatest messages I ever heard him preach is how he spoke about how if he could get out on that street today and not have no ride, and anybody in that congregation would stop traffic for miles just to pick him up and invite him home to their house. He was preaching the message on then and now. He said, "This is that was now. That was it." He said, "I don't need you to stop out there today. I got four or five cars waiting to take me and my ministry team to the motel. I don't need you today to do that. I needed you then to stop by that road." And how many of you know this was glory for this king, this man of high honor, to leave his post, Lord, I feel it, leave his throne, leave it, sound like Jesus, don't it? I said, sound like Jesus, don't it? Walking out of the heavenlies into the earthly to make a way for you and I to be promoted back in to the glory of God. Hallelujah! And for this king to step down, make his way to a forgotten prophet, laying on his deathbed, come into where he was. Oh my God. Brother Roberts used to tell a little different about the old man named Mose. Mose was a janitor in a school, didn't have nothing much, but a preacher come into their church to preach, and he was just a little young fella. Nobody thought he knew anything, and nobody would invite him home for dinner. And Brother Mose come up to that preacher and said, "We ain't got much, but I want you to come home with us." He said his wife cooked them biscuits and ham gravy, and they ate. When they got done, said he went to the back of the house, said they didn't have nothing. He had two old cane chairs, didn't have no back legs on. They stood them against the house and leaned against the house, talked the word all afternoon long. Said about 5 or 6 years later, that fella made the big time.
come in there, and he said that little old church was just busting out the seams. Come and you hear that man. He said, if anybody would take me home, my wife and I, for lunch today, and of course the whole church shot up. My God, we'll take him to dinner. We'll do it. He said, thank you kindly, but he looked way up in the back of the balcony up there, and he said, but I see old friend up there, Brother Mose. He said, Brother Mose, if you don't mind, I'm going back to your little house today. And said, you better remember how many times you stood your chair up for somebody on the back and they poured the life of God into you. That'll be more value to you in the days to come than it will be for 1,000 people to fall at your feet. That king laid down on that prophet, got in his ear, and these are what he said. My father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. Oh my God, that was the very words that Elisha had spoken when he saw his master go into heaven by way of a whirlwind. That was a place where he stepped out of the natural and got over into the supernatural. That was a place where he changed dimensions and changed realms. Oh, glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. And the same thing was said when the little servant opened up his eyes and saw the armies of God. He said, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And brother, when you start acknowledging that moment, when you separate from the natural and come over into the supernatural, you better know that you're submitting yourself for a new release of a prophetic direction into your life. Hallelujah. Amen. Sue and I know of a song that a brother wrote that said, my father, you are the chariots of Israel, and you're anointing the horsemen thereof. Holy Ghost, Lord of hosts, slay me to the uttermost till the sound of war's not heard in me anymore. Hallelujah. Brother, sister, when a king of high degree will join his faith with a prophetic realm of ministry and anointing, when a businessman will allow the prophet to come into his business, you hearing what I'm saying? When the layman on the seat allows the prophetic ministry of this Elisha anointing to go home with him. Ooh, you realize it'd be impossible for me to go home with every one of you today. But I can go home with you. I can send this word. Oh, the bus shot tire right out of this building. Right into your car. Right into your house. And then you, in return, can send it forth out of you into every direction till it begins to change. And the king said, they honored that anointing. Honored the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. What he said was, I still believe you got that anointing to do something about this mess in my least series is against us. And he's on the deathbed. He's sick. He can't even get out of bed. Brings me to my next point. It's time for the church to rise. Even the elderly have got to shake off this mindset that you're going to just pine away in weakness. Brother, that man was dying, and the anointing come on his deathbed, and he raised up off of that. When you're sick, you need to be under the anointing. Not in a room full of folks that will pet you and baby you, but in the anointing. That petting and babying will kill you. Kill you dead. Make you where you can't do nothing for yourself. It won't be long before you can't even get your own water. Can't even put your own shoes on. All because you got somebody pouring over you all the time. Then you say, praise the Lord. Somebody said, that sounds rough. I know it does. But you got to make a point where you rise up. I mean, we sitting in here with people who knows the truth about this. Oscar just been through this. He had to go through a time when he couldn't drink his own water, couldn't put his own shoes on. But the moment that he got where he could rise up, he begun to get up when they wouldn't come in there when he needed him. He just got up on his own and began to do it. And suddenly what happens?
them legs start working a little better. That back starts bending a little better. That strength starts coming a little. Oh, glory to God. When you're under the anointing, there's something that happens to your physical makeup. I mean, that body starts getting young again. That body starts responding to the word of the Lord. Woo, hallelujah. He got up and he told that man, take your bows and arrows. Now follow me on into this. That guy was a king. He knew war. He knew how to shoot bows and arrows. He was a marksman. He had to be. To even have had a bow in his possession meant that he knew when he left his kingdom to go to the prophets, if anybody messed with me along this journey, I know how to put them down. I know how to get rid of them. He had skill. Everybody say skill. He had strength. Everybody say strength. But on this day, when the prophet said, grab up your bow and arrow, it had nothing to do with skill, and it had nothing to do with strength. That's what I'm going to preach to you a few seconds right here. Get a hold of this. Your skill ain't worth nothing if God's anointing ain't on that skill. Your strength alone won't do it. You've got to have the strength of Jehovah. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I know how to preach. I've preached all my Lord over half my life. I've been doing this. I know how to preach. If I wanted to get with them religious, you know, gurus, I could work a crowd. I know when to raise, when to lower. When to shake, when to shimmy, I know how to get all of you going this morning. Praise the Lord. I've done it before. I know how to do it. I know how to preach for the pastor. I know how to decide, find out whatever church believes and make them happy, keep them happy. All that makes you, God, is a religious puppeteer. You want so many strings. Trouble is you get confused. And say one thing in one church that you've been to say in the other church. Somebody pulled the wrong string. Can you say amen? This part believes in definite sanctification, the other progressive. You mix them up and preach definite into progressive, and they won't have you back no more. Can you say amen? This church might allow wedding rings, and the other don't. You may forget why your wedding rings are the one that don't. You see what I'm telling you? Skill and strength is not the master of your fate. Oh, I feel that. The race doesn't go to the swift or the strong. Hello. Who's it go to? Him that's going to show the mercy of. Him that's going to stay with it. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, I feel a good anointing. I feel like telling every one of you that Zechariah 4 said, he said, what do you see, Zechariah? He said, well, I see a golden bowl. Well, what else do you see? It's full of gold and oil. He said, what else do you see? Seven pipes. Well, what's happening now? The oil's running out of that bowl and into them seven pipes. What else do you see? I see a seven-branch lampstand. What's happening now? The gold's running out of the pipes into the lamp. What else do you see? He said, wait a minute. Now he's getting down to the word now. He said, I see two trees, one on each side of this lampstand. He said, well, what are they doing? They're emptying oil into that bowl on top. He said, well, who are they? Zechariah said, I don't know who they are. He said, well, one of them's Joshua. And one of them's Zerubbabel. Joshua the high priest. Zerubbabel represented that kingly authority. Woo! He said, what are they called? The two sons of oil. My two witnesses in stand by the whole earth. There's that marriage, you see. You've got to have a union of the word and the spirit for anything to happen. And the Lord Zechariah said, do you mind clearing this up, telling me what all this means? He said, yes, I want you to go prophesy to Zerubbabel. Now let me help you with this. He was the governor that initiated the building of the temple. They had all got to helping him good. Everybody got on fire. Bless God, rock and roll, you know, let's get it done. They got it done all right. They got the foundation of it laid. And after they got the foundation laid, they all returned to their homes and spent all their time building on their house and putting roofs on their house and everything. And the temple of God laid out there getting rained on, and the foundation was flooded, and nobody had helped the man of God get the work done. And the word of the Lord came out of the prophet's mouth and said, "Who art thou, O mountain, that standeth before Zerubbabel? Or who hath despised the day of small things?" But I say, glory to God, the hands that have begun this work are the hands that will complete it or finish this work. And here it is now, for it is not my mind, it is not my power, but it is by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Skilled in the bow, skilled in the arrow, skilled in war. But it ain't no good if you ain't got an anointing on you. I know how to preach and work up a crowd, but my God, it won't make me have revival. Ooh, a flyer won't make you have revival. Advertising on Facebook won't make you have a move of God. It takes a genuine anointing of the Holy Ghost to have a revival. Glory to God. You can announce a meeting all you want to, but if there isn't a prophetic release of the glory of God, all you did was have a meeting. Are you hearing me? I said all you did was have a meeting. That's the reason I don't have them no more than I do. We have good service around here, glory services. I ain't holding no meeting till I hear from heaven. When I hear from heaven, I hold them. When I do, there's success. The crowd's good, the money's good, and the glory's good. But when I try to make them happen, the crowd stinks, the money stinks, and the rest of it stinks. Hallelujah. It's just a trying to get it done. To pull it back with the bow of strength. The precision and aim is skill. And to all of it, the Holy Ghost raised a half-dead prophet off of a bed.
That's right.
He went over and put his hands.
Yes.
He ain't no archer. He's not a man of the bow. He's not skilled. He don't even have enough strength to pull a bow cord back. But the prophetic marries the king. And it's no longer two men standing in front of that window. It's one anointed ministry. One anointed people of God. I hope you get that. Shalom, my son. Don't you know I can't make it all happen by myself? I got to have a marriage of anointings in here.
Amen.
Until we're one man with the same vision. As long as we got different visions, nothing ain't gonna happen. But when we become one united force with one vision, we're ready to shoot. Don't let go of that arrow until you believe, and then this is what I'm talking about with it. You gotta aim that thing. You gotta have a revelation of what he said. He put his hands over the prize. Can't you see that young, fresh, strong, lively, skilled, anointed, kingly man, old, wise, anointed, supernatural, spooky even, scary some days, prophet, wild-eyed, because he's always seeing in the spirit realm, laying his anointing on top. Makes me think of what Jesus told Peter in John 21:18. He said, when you was young, you girded your own self. And you went where you wanted to go. Did what you wanted to do. But he said, when you're old, oh glory to God, mature, when you come of age, you just go stretch your hands out. And Jesus said, and another's going to clothe thee. And said, when they get through clothing you, another's going to lead you. I hope you ain't carnal enough to think he's talking about an old man getting crippled and not being able to help himself no more. He's talking about a new ministry.
Yes.
That's going to get up in this last day. And bring in a new age. By saying, I don't care about my skill and I don't care about my strength. I just want anointing. I just want anointing. I just want anointing. How many is that place in your life you just want the anointing? It doesn't make any difference what you've known about the past. I will tell you right now, it don't make two bits what you know about me or what you think about what you know about me. The only thing matters is the anointing. The anointing. The anointing. I tell you, I don't care if that guy had a razor go through the middle of his head, shave him bald, and got two big old saddles on each side of his head. If he's got anointing, I'll walk with him through anything. I'm not worried about whether society receives him, accepts him, or whether the church receives or accepts him. I'm just looking for that special sound, that supernatural glory of God. Can you say praise the Lord, somebody? And when he said open a new window, and some of you are not going to see what you're looking to see because you're looking out in the wrong window. You don't see victory through the eyes of defeat. You can't see divine healing when you look through the eyes of disease and infirmity. You got to change your focus. Change your approach. Change your vision. Put the bills in the drawer. Quit leaving them on top of the desk. You can't pay them no way. You waiting on God to move on you with faith to get them paid. Quit reading them every day. Put them in the drawer. Well, glory to God. You know, oh, hallelujah. Excuse you. I'll be a little truthful here. If you's a big person and you's wanting to get little, you don't go in the closet and pull out that 3X large and hang it up and look at it every day, do you? No, you're going to get the medium one. And put it out every day. Some of you's trying to get a little waistline while staring at a 4XL top. And it ain't going to happen that way. You're not going to get an abundance of finance if the only thing you stare at every day is your empty bank account. Well, I'm preaching, you just don't know it. You're not going to get a major healing when all you do is get up every day and look for new spots. Well, glory. We better go, haven't we? Better time to quit. I'll have to come back and finish tonight. Let's leave it right there. You can't look through the same glass and expect a different result. Listen, you've been looking on the west side of that house long enough. That same tree with the broke limb still there. That same hole where you was going to plant a new one is still there empty. And every day you're going back for more abuse of failure. And in looking through that failure, yet telling everybody else, I'm expecting a miracle. I'm believing for God to move for me. Well, I can tell you now, there has to come an alignment. Your focus and vision is just as important as your mouth is and your words are. So you can say all day, but if you don't see, I said you can say all day, but if you don't see. And so we come to the conclusion, what am I supposed to do when these things are there? Well, it's very simple. Don't look at them. That's what you do. Turn away from them. Don't acknowledge them. Don't dwell on them. Don't. Are you hearing me? That elbow won't bend and it's so sore you can't move it. Slap a little aspirin cream on there and don't give it another thought the rest of the day. Don't sit down in the chair and say, wonder if that bone's out. Wonder if this is bruised. Wonder if that. You don't know how. Well, glory to God. You understanding me this morning? Get a new window open. Somebody open it. You know, I got to close. I told you I was shutting up. But Cricket's daughter, Crystal, she had an accident. And she fell off top of a swamp buggy. And boy, it hurt her. And she was in Tampa General. And they got her fixed up. But she's a nurse. So she's got more knowledge, you know, of these things. And sometimes that's wonderful. And then other times it's worse because it's harder to stay in faith and not look at the natural. And so she's doing fine. She had a lot of rough nights, but her mother's strong, and she prayed her through it, and they got fine. Then they got her home to her mother's house, and she got a view of the charts and found out what all had happened and what all was injured and what all had been done. And she got attacked. You know, it attacked her with, you know, fear of what she did. And so Cricky called me. She said, it ain't that she's that way physically. She's not. She's recovering well. But this thing's tormenting her, putting fear in her. I said, okay. And she said, would you come out? I said, yes, we'll come out. Heather and I went out. And they live way out on the other side of Haines City. We come in and sat down, talked a little bit, got ready to pray. We got ready to pray. Cricket's mother run over and opened the door. Well, we got to pray, and then the Holy Ghost took over, and God got prophesying. She got good prophecy. The minute the Holy Ghost took over, her mother run and shut that door. Hallelujah. When we got done in the spirit, and all Cricket told me, said, mother opens the door for the bad to go out. And said, once the bad goes out, she shuts the good in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And we're going to take up there tonight if the Lord is so prepared. I mean, enjoy the Spirit of God in this house. Boy, I tell you what a shouting time and then what a word time. I've enjoyed these words I've given you. Their truth, their spirit, and their life. And I'll tell you, we're going to come in here tonight and see what it means, what it is to leave one side of the house. The familiarity of it. Sometimes you need to move your furniture to the other side of the room and look at some new scenery. I think I could tell this. I don't think that Christina won't mind me telling this, but that, you know, after Peggy and Greg passed away, and she had not meant it that way. It's just while they were living, you know, she had a wall in her house because that was her family, and she had their pictures on there, you know. And it was getting hard to overcome as time went on. And she was heard a preacher come on the TV. And she started teaching, preaching, and telling, you know, about how when that to get that spirit of grief off of you, sometimes you just have to break up, you know, the memorabilia. Yeah. Not get rid of it, but scatter it out where it's not your focus all the time. And she said she got up by the witness of the Spirit and started to move off that wall, that those pictures, so that it was not just one big shrine to them. Right. And the Lord begun to heal that, you know, cause it to pass from her, where it became memories of good, memories of, you know, wonderful things and things of that. And what happened? Her focus got back where it's at. And sometimes I have had to get up. Come on now, I'm talking about natural now. I've had to get up and get my sofa.
Right.
What did Jesus say? Take up your bed and walk.
Yeah.
Lord, I just felt that go through me. Take up your bed and walk. Move to another neighborhood. Move to another place in this house. God, I feel more glory on that right now. Move to another city, another town. I ain't talking about geography. I'm talking about Holy Ghost. Get up and set your sights on another part, on another place, and start looking from a different view and a different angle. Can you say amen? You know, I've always believed that if I put it my Bible here, and I prayed and believed God to move that Bible over there, the dumbest thing in the world for me to do would be to go back here to look for that Bible. I better go over there where I moved it. To every time. Once you have believed, whether it's for finance, healing, peace, prosperity, the dumbest thing you can do, I don't mean to use words like dumb and fool, but it is. I mean, you need something strong enough to show you just how inconceivable it is to go back to the place it was and find what you asked him to do. It don't work that way. You only look for the unseen, what you believe him to do, not for the way it is now. And I'm going to tell you, if you're still adolescent and immature enough that when people say things like that to you, your response is, well, if you just knew what I knew, if you're still in that baby stage, then it's going to take more than my sermon this morning to help you. You need to get a whole stack of CDs and play them day and night until your faith is to the point that you've outgrown your little tantrum. Nobody has it bad as mine. Nobody knows the trouble I'm in. Nobody knows. Well, you get out of that mess. Yeah. Some of y'all are, listen to me, you've had the Holy Ghost 20 years.
That's right.
And you still get offended if anybody preaches faith to you. Yeah. Grow up. Spit out the bottle. We're not skillful in meat and milk around here. We're skillful in meat. And you say amen. Oh, if you's going through what I was going, oh, if you had it like, just like nobody in the world had, listen to me. Folks, that was a king. That was a king. That was a man of honor. But he was scared to death because Syria was no whooping. Brother, sister, everybody in this room this morning can walk the plank of defeat or jump up on the spring of victory and say, I'm coming out of this in Jesus' name. This is not going to dictate to me any longer. Amen. And if you're doing a lot of crying, stop it. In the name of Jesus. And if you're doing a lot of whining, shut it up. Start laughing all the time. Laugh, 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 laugh. And if you're crying because you feel the Holy Ghost, baby, cry out of the river fills up. But if you're crying because it's defeat and you just don't know what's happening, shut it up. In the name of Jesus. For God's sake, if you're going to talk to me, shut it up. Because I got this whole church and my whole family to keep in that heavenly realm. Yeah. And I ain't got time to listen to Holy Ghost filled tongue talking believers tell me it can't be done when the Word of God said it can't be done. Then you say, praise the Lord. Lord Jesus, seal up the words of this book. God, I got people listening to me right now. They believe it's going to change. They know it's going to change. They're believing in their bodies. They're believing in their finances. They're believing for their kids. They're believing for their household. And just as sure as I can convince them to go open the other window, the prophetic anointing's going to come up behind them and overtake them. And they're getting ready to shoot a brand new arrow. Whoa, hallelujah. Glory. A deliverance arrow. One that's going to cut through, penetrate, and open up a clear way for victory. And I thank you right now that as the Word of God said, that we read this morning, until every one of them Syrians is consumed. That's what we're after, God. We don't want no fixer-upper. We want a whole new house. We want one that's renovated already. We don't want to have to go in and fix holes all over the place and try to fix what somebody else has just messed over. We want it right. Oh, Shamande Leboho Sanda. The Lord thy God would speak and say unto thee that I'm making things beautiful even as you sit here in my presence this day. And yea, saith the Lord, I'm delivering thee from familiarity. And yea, the mistakes have become familiar and the pain has become familiar. But I say I run it out of thy midst this day, saith God. And I introduce thee, Labashanda, to knowing what it is to feel that goodness and to see that perfection in operation, saith God. The Lord would say unto thee, I'm refocusing thy eyesight. I'm refocusing thy vision, saith the Lord. And yea, ye shall no longer get used to seeing things in a blur and in a fog. Oh, but I'm clarifying it for you this day, says God. And you will look and see a clear picture. Woo! For know this, that even as my glory gets heavy and thick and foggy, know that when it lifts, it's only wiped clean so that you can see clearly, says the Spirit of the Lord. And you can go up in my presence and come down into this earth and see things from a heavenly point of view, say of God. So I do say unto thee, you ought to look from where I'm looking from. For all I see is glory, and all I see is healing, and all I see is my word at work, saith God. So come up here and sit a while with me. Shamahata, Ikamahosa, Hakabaritio, Rostondala Mahashandere, Ribio Toya. Come sit a while with me, said the Spirit. Come sit a while with me and look at it from my point of view. Yea, I'm changing my point of view. Oh, hallelujah, I'm changing my point of view. This day saith the Lord. And you're going to look from a new perspective, because you're going to look from the height of Zion and see a finished work, saith the Lord. Woo, hallelujah. Well, stand up, let's thank you this morning. Glory to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Ha, ha, ha. At the risk of sounding like my granddad always said, if you listen to me, what did he say? I can help you. That's what I'm here for. Lord. And I can. If I'm under the anointing, I can help you anytime. Oh, my Shanda. Oh, glory. Well, let's rejoice in the Lord by giving. We're going to give before we leave today. Tithes and offerings. If you got the mission money from Nicaragua, you ought to put in, you put it in. And we bless you. You be dismissed as you give in the name of the Lord. Amen.